Turn with me, if you would, to Matthew chapter 7. Book of Matthew chapter 7. Last week when I spoke, we talked about setting goals and accomplishing more with our lives by just being focused on doing that sort of thing. If you will also recall that during the sermon, I suggested that most often than not, specialists in this arena of setting goals and achievement and accomplishment tell us that we should begin with the end in mind. That helps us get ourselves focused on where we want to be going. We also learned that this year and many other years at the Feast of Tabernacles that we are learning to become righteous judges eventually, as well as develop righteous character as Christians. What I'd like to do today is use the Sermon on the Mount to be able to help us learn some lessons of life that can assist us in all of the things that we are expected to do and become as Christians, including becoming a righteous judge, including becoming an individual developing righteous character. But rather than going to the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, I want to go to the end. I want to start with the end in mind, if you will. We'll begin in Matthew 7, where Jesus Christ is sort of wrapping it up after he's given this very eloquent sermon on the Sermon on the Mount, and putting a conclusion and a summary on the total sermon and presentation that he had made to this multitude of people. Let's begin here in Matthew 7 and verse 21. Matthew 7 and verse 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. So in this one statement, Jesus Christ is showing us that words, comments that we make are no substitute for the deeds in our lives. We can talk the talk all we want, but if we don't walk the walk, the talk is meaningless. Then he continues on in verse 22. He says, many are going to say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name and cast out demons in your name and done many wonders in your name? Haven't we done all these fantastic things in your name? Using Christ's name and doing things of the charismatic sort of gift of nature won't mean anything because of non-action in other important areas of an individual's life. We can talk all we want about how we are a Christian. We can talk all we want about, Lord, we're doing this in your name, we're doing that in your name, I've done this in your name, I've done that in your name. But if we haven't done all of the other basics that God and Jesus Christ expect of us, Jesus Christ is telling us, you know, it's going to really mean very little in our lives. And he goes on, verse 23, he says, and then I will declare to them, these individuals that said, Lord, we did this and we did that and we did this and we did that, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. And here he plants the seed of thought. That living by God's laws, living by God's way of life, is an all-inclusive thing that is expected of us. It is the basis from which everything else springs. It's the foundation, if you will, of being a Christian, doing what God asks us to do, not doing what God asks us not to do. In other words, they did not practice the way of life that he had just outlined for them in this Sermon on the Mount. He told them the totality of the way to live life. He said, so you can't just talk about it, you've got to actually live it. In other words, he's talking about words without action. Then he goes on to explain with a parable here in verse 24. He said, therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. What sayings is he referring to? The sayings in the sermon that he had just given them, the lessons for life, the lessons of life sermon, the Sermon on the Mount, if you will, as we know it. He said, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. It had a solid foundation. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. It's really interesting when you read this analogy and then you have a rainy day. Just go for a walk through a neighborhood and see stuff that's got all kinds of sand around it. And what happens in a heavy rain with sand? It gets washed away, doesn't it? You can see these little rivulets and valleys and little plows where the water's just washed the sand away. But where you see rock, nothing's happened. The water just runs off of it. This is what Jesus Christ is telling us. Isn't it said the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house and it fell? Now, he could have just ended it right there and it would have been a powerful statement, but he adds five more words. And great was its fall. Now, why would it be great? Why would the fall be great? What he's saying is it's going to be dramatic. It's going to be almost earth-shattering to the individual. Why is it great? Because the individual thought everything was okay. Hey, I built it on a foundation. I built it solid, and I built it right. But the misconception was he did not build it on a solid foundation. And the fall is great because he thought everything was cool, but it wasn't. This is hearing without action. Verse 28, and so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at his teachings. For he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. He was telling them like it was. Jesus Christ, from the very beginning of his ministry, was telling people what they needed to know to be able to accomplish what he came to this earth to assist them in accomplishing. He came to this earth to die for them so that the death penalty could be paid, so that they could go to God, repent, God forgive their sins, live a godly life, and then one day enter the kingdom of heaven. That's what his purpose was. That's why he was so serious about it. That's why he kept, quote unquote, harping about it, which is what happens with preachers when we keep talking about things that people need to do. People come up to me sometimes after service, man, do you always have to keep harping on that subject? Yeah, I probably do. For you to make that kind of a comment to me, you just verified I need to keep doing that. Let's begin now and look at these teachings that everybody was so astonished about. These principles of life, these lessons of life, if you will, which is what I've titled this sermon, Lessons of Life. Here in Matthew 5, let's go back to the beginning now, just a couple pages back, the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew 5, we're going to see these lessons and guidelines for how to live a life of not only accomplishments and achievements, as we talked about last time, but one of a real Christian, one who has a foundational base on which he can build a really positive, powerful, and meaningful life. Let's begin in Matthew 5 and verse 1. Matthew 5, 1. And seeing the multitudes, he went up on a mountain, and when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, I want to point out something here that Jesus Christ was teaching. He was educating them. He was giving them guidelines that he wanted them to incorporate into their life. School was in session, if you will, and Jesus Christ was the instructor. God probably inspired Matthew to catch these high points of this sermon, because I'm sure this isn't word for word what the sermon was all about. And any one of these points could become a sermon of and by themselves, and we've heard sermons on some of these points we're going to talk about here today. Let's begin the sermon here and see what I mean. And as we do, I'd like to ask you to keep in mind something that we saw earlier about the conclusion of the sermon, what Jesus Christ said. We will see, especially in the beginning, in something that has become known as the Beatitudes, that actions are tied to blessings. Jesus Christ says, do this and you will get this, okay? Verse 3 of Matthew 5, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We have learned elsewhere in the Bible that this is for referring to those with humility, those who have a humble heart, a humble spirit. not thinking of themselves greater than anybody else, but always thinking of other people as constantly as they think about themselves. Verse 4, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Having the capacity to feel for others, caring, empathetic, sympathetic, is a blessing from God. It's one of the attitudes from which God says springs forth true Christian life. And he said, if we have that kind of an approach to other people, he said, you will be comforted. You will be given the comfort you need when you need it, if we give it to others when they need it. In other words, feeling someone else's pain can bring comfort to us. Verse 5, he said, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. I love how the New English Bible translation puts this verse. It says, how blessed are those of a gentle spirit. If you stop and think about that, it's really, you've met people like that. They are just a gentle spirit, and they're such a pleasure to be around. They can be encouraging, they can be funny, they can be helpful, they can listen when they need to, because their spirit is just so gentle, there's nothing aggressive in it whatsoever. It just wants to be there to help if it can. In verse 6, he said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. And I would add here, probably in ways that we're not even able to imagine of yet. Because what he's talking about here, hungering and thirsting for righteousness, I mean, think about what you feel like at the end of the Day of Atonement. You are hungering and thirsting for water and food, aren't you? And you would do just about anything for that glass of cold water, ice cold water after it's done. Doesn't that sound like fabulous, breaking a fast with that? That attitude is what Jesus Christ is saying we should have about the righteousness of God. Hungering and thirsting for that, not being able to get enough of that into our minds, not being able to get enough of it into our beings. And how are we going to do that? As was suggested last week during that sermon, maybe a new project for us to tackle this year is read the Bible. I'm not talking about just read the Bible. I mean, read the Bible in 1 year. If you've never done it, it takes some effort. You have to read 2 to 3 chapters almost every day, maybe 4. There's a website that you can go to, studyyourbible.org, studyyourbible.org. It gives you a day-by-day reading if you want to follow through it. I know we're on day 7 already, but you can just start day 1 with day 7 or get caught up. And just make it a focus of yours to read the entire Bible for an entire year. I mean, if you stick your nose into God's Word that often, I can absolutely guarantee you, I know I can make this guarantee, you're going to learn something that you thought you already knew but didn't. It's almost an impossibility not to. Hungering and thirsting after righteousness and Jesus Christ, they said, they're going to be fulfilled. They're going to be filled. Verse 7, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. This concept and approach is common thread throughout this entire sermon that he's given here on the Sermon on the Mount, admonishing us to be a certain way so that we can receive that same kind of response in our life. And Jesus Christ has said, blessed are the merciful, those people who show mercy to other individuals and don't hold grudges and just keep moving forward, are going to be given mercy when they need it. And we all need that. We all make mistakes where we need mercy. Spiritually we need it, physically we need it. And Jesus Christ is saying, the more merciful you are, the more you're going to be given mercy in your own life. Verse 8, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. And this purity is what makes it possible for God to look upon them and bless them, to look upon them and hear their prayer. Because they're pure of heart. There's no agenda. There's no hidden purpose. There's no hidden meaning in their life. They're not trying to accomplish their own will. They're just trying to accomplish what God wants them to do with their lives, and they're doing the best they can. And they don't judge others that can't do a good enough job to meet their standards. We're all on a different plane. We all have different challenges. We all have different needs. We all have different talents and abilities. So our ability to be able to achieve spiritually the same way is virtually impossible. That's why God says he doesn't want us judging one another. Just if you want to judge somebody, judge yourself. Put yourself to the standard you know you should be held to and see how you are doing. You talk about a humbling experience, that'll humble you every single day. And then he goes on in verse 9, he says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. And it's interesting, this terminology that he's using for each one of these phrases, you know, they shall see God, they shall obtain mercy, they shall be filled, they shall be called sons of God. The sons of God is for peacemakers, always looking for a way to calm or quell a situation and do anything you can to not exacerbate it. Whether it's between you and somebody else and other people, whatever it is, Jesus Christ is saying, try to be a peacemaker. Try to bring salve to the wound. Try to help people resolve differences and difficulties. And trying to stay away from actions and words that can inflame a situation. And we all know what those words and actions are. But sometimes they just come out of us. Because they come out of us so frequently. And sometimes we just act a certain way because we act a certain way so frequently. And we don't think about it. And we don't temper it. And then we realize after we did it, it hurt somebody. And we inflamed a situation or created a bad situation. In verse 10, he says, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Jesus Christ began the Beatitudes with the kingdom of heaven in the very first verse as the reward. And here he ends the Beatitudes with the kingdom of heaven as the reward. It's because the kingdom of heaven is the ultimate reward for everything that we do in this life. And Jesus Christ said, I really need for you to hunger and thirst for that kingdom. Because that will be the motivator that you need to keep you on track, to keep you going down the right path, and to keep you solidly grounded when the earth around you starts falling apart. I just heard something last week that was one of the most unnerving things I've heard in a long time. I didn't realize this, and I don't even know if it's being reported. The United States is sending an artillery unit to NATO. 87 tanks, brand new, top-of-the-line tanks, artillery armory, are being sent to the NATO border with 3,500 airborne troops out of fear of what Russia is doing on the other side of the border. The world is preparing for war. You don't send 87 tanks to a borderline for no reason. Things are happening around this world, brethren, that are going to unnerve us when we start realizing that things are starting to collapse. It may recover, it may get better again, I don't know. But we need to be aware of all these things and have the kingdom of heaven be our focus in life and everything that we're doing, everything we're saying, everything we're thinking and accomplishing. It is our expected behavior in our lessons of life. He follows on this point with an explanation and a personalization of this whole important point, verse 11. Blessed are you when they revile you and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad when that happens. For great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. It appears that if being persecuted for what we believe and how we serve God comes our way, there is an added blessing attached to that that Jesus Christ is talking about here. But he's saying, be prepared to handle it. Be prepared to be persecuted for what you believe, for what you stand for. And if you think that's not coming, again, you're not staying in touch with what's going on in the world. Christians are being focused and persecuted, purely because they practice Christianity now in the world. I mean, for no other reason. Verse 13. He said, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men." We've had sermons and sermonettes over the years about the salt of the earth and what it means, about being the salt. Being the salt of the earth is a function of being able to add flavor, if you will, enhancements, joy to those in whom we come in contact with in this world. Jesus Christ said, if we can't be that, then it's like salt that doesn't salt. It doesn't flavor it. They just throw it away. You get rid of it. You don't use it anymore. It becomes dirt under the ground. But he doesn't stop with salt. He goes on in verse 14. He said, "You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand so it can shine and glow and give off light to everybody else. And it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." What is he talking about? He's talking about living a good quality Christian life. Doing things that the average person just wouldn't do. Let me give you some mundane thoughts to consider. You're in a supermarket. You're walking down the aisle, and a package of spaghetti falls on the floor, but you didn't touch it. You didn't knock it off. It just fell. What do? Keep walking? 99 times out of 100 people just keep right on walking. What should a Christian do? Bend over and pick it up. Put it back on the shelf. Somebody gets out of a car and a piece of garbage flies out of the car and they don't even pay any attention to it. They may even not even know it's there. You can let it fly around in the parking lot. It's going to get trampled on. Tires are going to run over it. Eventually it'll disintegrate and stuff. What would the Christian thing be to do? Pick it up and throw it in the trash. You see somebody else's yard where you've walked year after year, day after day, and all of a sudden you see a giant pile of dog poop. And you know it's a widow that lives there. Most people are just going to let it go, hoping that it'll just get washed away in the rain. What would the Christian thing be to do? Go home, get a bag, get a piece of wood, scrape it up, throw it away. What I'm talking about here is let people see you behave differently to other people. That's simply what all this passage of Scripture is saying. Doesn't mean you stand on top of a soapbox looking around, looking for ways that you can start chanting and talking about God and Jesus Christ and stuff like that. He says, no, he said, I don't want the words. I want the actions. He says, so they can see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. There is a lot there. Let's look at one point about being a light, though. Our good works must come from the position of serving God, not being seen of men. If we do it because we're wanting somebody else to see us do it so they think us to be better than they did before, then it doesn't have any value. Then it doesn't have any bearing. There's a big difference. Later on in Matthew 6, verses 1 through 4, if you want to go there, he talks about that. I'm not going to turn there today. Next, Jesus addresses the law and what the spirit of the law should be. Remember, he talked about living the law, living, abiding by the law, and if you don't do that, you're not doing what I've asked you to do. Not just keeping it, but understanding the spiritual intent of the law. Verse 17, do not think that I come to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly, I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled. In other words, it's not going to change. Whoever therefore breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does and teaches them, he should be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Basically, what he's giving us is a guide for self-examination. Ask yourself, how are you doing? How are we doing at really living up to what God expects from us on our day-to-day lives? We have a standard that we are expected to live up to. If you've been in the church for 20 years, that standard has never changed. 30 years standard has never changed. 40 years standard has never changed. But what happens after we've been in the church for 20, 30, 40, 50 years? We've been doing it for so long, it's like we do it by rote now. We don't even think about it. And sometimes because we don't think about it, we really don't do it the way God expected us to be doing it. And it's a good idea to go back and just reassess it. He then goes on to explain the points he just made about the law. He expands on this a bit. Matthew 5:21. You have heard that it has been said of those of old, you shall not murder. And whoever murders will be in danger of the judgment. I say to you, it goes up a notch. I say to you, whoever is angry with his brother without cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whoever says, you fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. He's just talking about having a total disregard for another human being. He said, you know that whole thing about you shall not murder? Because that's just the tip of the iceberg. You need to understand spiritually where that came from. And that's what he's explaining here. Here's Christ's first expansion, if you will, of the understanding of the laws that most have already had an awareness about. Jewish leaders of that day actually taught that nothing except actual murder was forbidden by the sixth commandment. Jesus Christ shows it goes way, way, way beyond that. I mean, magnitudes beyond that. Verse 23, therefore, keep in mind on the heels of what we just read, you know, talking about your brother in a really disregarding way. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar and there you remember that your brother is something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. Why does he say that? Because if you're offering a gift and you're not reconciled with your brother, your gift is not going to be accepted. You may as well not even give your gift. It may be prayer, it may be offering, it may be whatever you're doing. You know, this involves a lot in our lives. It talks about prayer, talks about forgiveness, talks about the Passover symbols, if you will. Just about every aspect of our lives hinges on this behavior. Knowing that we are right with each other. Desiring to have that pure heart that Christ talked about earlier before God. Verse 25. He takes it a step further here, and this is sort of irritating to people when you start getting into this dialogue. Agree with your adversary quickly while you are on the way with him, lest your adversary deliver you to the judge hand you over to the officer, and you get thrown into prison. Don't let your arrogance get in the way. Stop it cold. Eat crow. I'm not telling you eat a dirty bird, but you get the point. This is a continuation of that concept of anger and hatred. He said, assuredly, I say to you, you by no means get out of there until you've paid the last penalty. He said, they'll just rape you from a penalty standpoint. Agree and move on. Don't feel like you have to have a pound of flesh. The pound of flesh is going to cost you many more pounds. He said, it's just not worth it. And you know, as you stop and think about it, all these legal troubles that people get themselves all worked up in and attitudes that they develop and things like this, it's all about attitude. But it's just not right. They shouldn't have done that to me. Jesus Christ said, you know what? Consider where this could lead you. You could be a mess when this is all over. Then he continues with another expansion, if you will, of the law, verse 27. He says, you have heard that it was said of those of old, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that whoever looks at a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery in his heart and therefore sinned. He then continues expanding on this point with another analogy. If your right eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you, for it is more profitable for you to be with that one of your members perish than your whole body to be cast into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you, for it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish than your whole body to be cast into hell. See, if you got something that's a problem, you need to fix it. Because if you don't fix it, you're not going anywhere fun. It's going to be a worthless way down life. Here Jesus is making a point that this type of sin many times begins with what we see with our eyes. Then this seeing leads into a temptation. This is also inferring an attitude of concern for others by the way we behave sometimes, and even by the way we dress. This has been more especially for women. But if you know that the way you're going to dress is going to cause an issue for somebody else sexually, you shouldn't be doing it. It follows that if this sin is openly acted upon, it's probably done via our hands. Eyes, heart, hands. It's a progression. The eye is the organ through which the wrong thought is stimulated. The hand is the limb by which it is put into action. He says, once the mind gets going on with what you've seen, he says, it's really hard to control it afterward. Christ then leads into divorce. Sort of a natural follow-up if you stop and think about it. Verse 31, furthermore, it has been said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you, whoever divorces his wife for any reason except sexual immorality causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a woman who is divorced commits adultery. Again, he expands on the concept that has been misused and abused all throughout life. Later, Paul had expounded on this further to show that divorce could also include abandonment. Abandonment physically, emotionally, and spiritually. The next section, verses 33 through 37, deal with being truthful and negating the needs for oaths and swearing. Drop down to verse 38. Matthew 5, verse 38. You have heard that it was said before, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I tell you not to resist an evil person. But whoever slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other to him also. This goes against our grain, doesn't it? Somebody affronts us, we want to retaliate. Jesus Christ said that's not the way to do it. Keep in mind, he's giving people the guidelines about how to live life. He said, if anybody wants to sue you and take away your tunic, give him your cloak also. End it. Don't perpetuate it. End it. And whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with him too. In other words, take the high road. Always take the high road. Give to him who asks you, and from him who wants to borrow from you, do not turn away. It's all an attitude of giving with no expectation of getting anything in return. He then continues, seemingly expanding even deeper on this concept. Now we get into what one person has described to me in the past as you've gone from preaching to meddling. Verse 43. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. I say to you, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use and persecute you. That's hard to do, isn't it? That's really hard to do. But guess what? That's what the expectation is. That's what Jesus Christ is saying. If you're really interested in getting into the kingdom of God, this is the way you've got to live. It can't be some of these things some of the time. It's all of these things all of the time. He said that you may be sons of your Father in heaven, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good. He sends rain on the just and he sends rain on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? That's easy. Do not even the tax collectors do the same? Don't the evil people in the world do the same thing? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so also? Brethren, this is one of the toughest things to do as a Christian. But guess what? Not me telling you to do this. Not me even suggesting you do this. It's Jesus Christ saying it's the only way to go. It's the only way to live. It's a requirement, as iterated by our Savior. All of this, when we read these very well-known and oft-quoted scriptures next, verse 48, therefore you shall be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. I believe what Jesus Christ has shown us here is that perfection, which is expected, springs from this relationship behavior we just read about, which actually revolutionizes attitudes. If you stop and think about it, if we were to practice all these things that Jesus Christ said, and I can see some of you squirming when I mention some of these things, because it's not easy. It's actually really quite hard, some of them. If you think about it, if we were to live our lives that way, it would totally change our attitudes about almost every aspect of life. This is how perfection, how becoming a Christian, a child of God, can come about. Then in the first four verses of chapter 6, Jesus expands on doing good and being seen of others. Verse 6, verse 1, chapter 6. Take heed that you do not do your charitable deeds before men to be seen of them, otherwise you have no reward from your Father in heaven. Therefore, when you do a charitable deed, do not sound a trumpet before you as hypocrites do in the synagogue and in the streets that they may have glory from men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But when you do your charitable deed, whatever it is, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, that your charitable deed may be done in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will himself reward you openly. You want to do good for another human being? Don't march in and let everybody see you handing them this and handing them that and doing this for them and doing that. Do it behind the scenes, secretly, so that only you and them know that it's happening. And what's even more fun, I have found, if you can do it and not even let them know who did it. That's when it's really cool. That's a bit more of a challenge, though. And on the heels of this concept, he discusses praying. When you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites. For they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets so that it may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward, being seen by other people. But when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut the door, pray to your Father who is in secret, in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they're going to be heard for their many words. And Jesus Christ talked about that earlier. It's not the words, it's the actions. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you even ask him. He just wants to hear it come across your lips. Then Jesus gives us the form for our prayers, and that we should be not repeated vainly, just using this as an outline to go by. It's a model. It's a form that we can follow. Just fill in the blanks. In this manner, therefore, pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Talking about the different phases of a prayer. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us not our debts as we forgive our debtors. Tremendous lesson right there. Do we really pray that? Father, forgive me the same way I forgive other people. If we do, I can guarantee you're going to be starting to give more forgiveness to people. It's just going to happen. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. That's the model. Right on the heels of the prayer of model praying, he expounds on one point, and that's the point of forgiveness in the prayer. Verse 14, for if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. We need to understand that. This is a lesson for all of us to learn and adhere to. He then discusses the concept of fasting, which we are expected to do, and not just on the Day of Atonement. Verse 16, moreover, when you fast, do not be like the hypocrites with sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces, that they may appear to men to be fasting. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. He keeps repeating that. But you, when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face and come out of the chute like a bull on fire. Nobody's going to know you're fasting. You're ready to rock and roll. You're going to work. You're working hard. You're working long. You're working fast. Instead of eating, you go maybe pray a little bit, do a little Bible study. You come back, work even harder, full of energy, full of excitement, smile on your face. Nobody in the world would ever guess that you're fasting. That's what he's talking about. So that you do not appear to men to be fasting, but your Father who is in secret place and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. Jesus Christ said, you know, you just got to trust God. Do it privately and let him take over. And it's going to become a very apparent thing to you that he has seen your behavior, your righteous behavior, and he's blessing you for it. He then points out that investing in and in out of our spiritual future is a much greater dividend than investing in our physical future. Verse 19, do not lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, treasures on earth before, where neither moth nor rust destroy, neither thieves may break in and steal, for where your treasure is, there your heart's going to be also. He talked about our hearts, now refers to our eyes once again in verse 22. The lamp is the body of the eye. If therefore your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. Think about it. It's like he's talking about your eyes are what sees what's going on in the world around you. And the way you respond to that, it just does something to your entire being. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is in darkness, how great is that darkness? Things are going awry and you don't even realize it because your eyes are all messed up. The way we're looking at life, the way we're looking at things, our perspective is what he's talking about in the way we look at things in life. You've probably heard the saying that your eyes are the windows to your souls in times past. There's a degree of truth to that. Where we allow our eyes to go in this life is an indication of where our heart and our spirit are going. He continues to expound on this by elaborating on more analogies, showing us that our eyes, minds, and focus what they should be. Verse 24, he said, no one can serve two masters, for either you will hate the one and love the other, or else you're going to be loyal to one and despise the other. You can't serve God and mammon. Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you eat and what you drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. For they neither sow nor reap nor gather for barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable than them? Which of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to his stature? So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, and yet I tell you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. We just saw a specialty last night on the jungles of Borneo or something like that. It was one of these National Geographic special things. And one of the highlights that they had on this presentation was the birds that live on this island. It was absolutely breathtaking, the color and the beauty and the variety of these birds. They showed hummingbirds, and they showed the varieties of little hummingbirds and how they're the beauty of them. And then some of them have this iridescent capability to be able to like shine like a light once they turn their body to a certain way in the sunlight. And what Christ is telling us here is all of these things that we see in life, God created and God designed them, and we're sitting here worrying about, oh, do I have enough food? Do I have enough clothing? Do I have enough house? Do I have enough gas in the car? Do I? See, quit worrying. Remember the sermon we gave just a couple, 3 months ago? Jesus Christ said, I've given you everything you need for today. Focus on today. Nothing more. Don't worry about yesterday. And don't worry about tomorrow. Don't fret over the past. Don't worry about what's coming down the road. Just take care of today. Because when tomorrow arrives, guess what? I'm going to give you everything you need for that day. Stay focused on the now, as far as our lives are concerned. Drop down to verse 33. He said, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things are going to be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble." Chapter 7, verse 1. He goes into this judging concept now. "Judge not that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you're going to be judged. And with the measure you use, that's the measure going to be used right back at you." Sort of like the forgiveness thing. God says, you know, you want to be judged righteously? You want to be given a fair shake in life? You better be doing that to other people, because the way you do it to other people is exactly how God's going to give it back to you. "Why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye and do not consider the plank in your own eye?" Have you ever noticed how good we are at analyzing other people and tearing them apart for whatever their flaws are or their weaknesses are? We're really good at that as human beings, aren't we? Christ is saying, you know what? If you want to do that, stand in front of a mirror. Tear that person apart. Analyze that person if you want to do that. Or how can you say in verse 4 to your brother, "Let me remove the speck from your eye, and look, a plank is in your own eye"? Hypocrite! First remove the plank from your own eye, and then you'll be able to clearly remove the speck from your brother's eye, because you're going to be doing it with compassion and love. Drop down to verse 6. "Do not give what is holy to the dogs, nor cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under feet and tear you in pieces." Lesson of discernment. And not just throwing out the precious truth of God to just anybody for any reason. Ask for wisdom. Ask for discernment. I mean, that's one of the things I pray about daily, is asking God to give me discernment, to be able to know what's right, what's wrong, what's good, what's bad, what's not so right, what's not so good. Christ goes on to the benefit of prayer and praying often. And this promise that comes with it, verse 7, "Ask and it's going to be given to you. Seek and you're going to find. Knock and it's going to be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and him who knocks it will be opened. Or what man is there among you who, if his son asks for bread, is going to give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, is he going to give him a serpent? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to you, to those who ask him?" It then touches on our behavior toward others again. He just keeps coming back to that. "Therefore, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them. For this is the law in the prophets." And as soon as he admonishes how to treat our fellow man, he talks about making it into the kingdom, doesn't he? Verse 13, "Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it." Do you think maybe he knew this would be one of our biggest stumbling blocks in life, in how we treat each other? Jesus Christ harps on this over and over and over again. Paul talked about this over and over and over again. It's because it's one of the biggest weaknesses as human beings, treating other people with respect, love, care, and concern. He then wraps things up with an admonition about spiritual teachers and leaders. Again, a lesson of discernment. Verse 15, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear good fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit." It's an impossibility. "Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them." In other words, you know enough now if you practice this way of life that I've given you in this sermon, he is saying, to be able to discern the right from the wrong, the good from the bad, and the righteousness from the evil. All you have to do is observe how they behave. And if they don't behave properly, you don't mess with them. And then we are back to where we started. Let's end by reading a couple of them over again. Verse 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Then drop to verse 24. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. Brethren, Jesus Christ gave us these sayings of his, if you will, for a reason. He wanted us to know how to live our lives, to grow in the wisdom of God, to be able to advance in our training as future judges and leaders of God's people now and in the kingdom. He wants us to learn from these lessons of life for our life eternal. Have a great Sabbath.